Willkommen. Ich werde heute über Flapjack reden. Aber zuerst möchte ich mich bei NetWase bedanken, die jedes Jahr die Konferenz ausrichten. Das ist jetzt das fünfte oder sechste Mal, dass ich dabei bin. Das erste Mal als Sprecher im Sinne von, dass ich nicht NetWase-Mitarbeiter bin. Und deswegen habe ich auch auf meinem Badge nur einen Stern, wo ich ganz traurig bin. Und ja, NetWase hat mich gebeten, den Talk in Englisch zu machen. Therefore, I will go in English for this talk. And yeah, let's just start. Who's that guy? And what company is he working for? I'm Birger Schmidt and work for Bulletproof. Since mid-2012, I am an R&D engineer at Bulletproof. Bulletproof is based in Sydney, Australia. And before that, I was consultant and trainer at NetWase. I have a degree in computer science, and since the beginning of the 90s, I worked in IT infrastructure, operating and development. Today, some of us call that DevOps. Yeah, it's just a tech. Who's Bulletproof? Bulletproof is a quite fast-growing company in Sydney. We have a department in the US, and Bulletproof was founded in the year 2000 as a managed service provider. And in the year 2006, Bulletproof turned to be the first VMware-based public cloud service in Australia. And as of now, just last year, we started to sell managed AWS and are quite successful with that. These are a few of our customers. We host for the Australian government. They publicize their budget on the website that we host. Maybe our biggest customer is Movember. I will come to that a bit later. And maybe the most well-known over here is Aldi. Aldi is also available in Australia. What is the agenda for today? The who? We've already done that. You know where I am now. And the what? It's all about Flapjack. And it's called Flapjack, not pancake or something like that. And I will talk about the motivation behind Flapjack, the history of Flapjack, some surrounding facts, some background in terms of monitoring, and I will talk about the architecture of Flapjack, some about the documentation that we have, and if that works, I will give you a demo. That's a quote from the Flapjack website, flapjack.io. Flapjack is a highly scalable and distributed monitoring notification system. It sits on top of existing monitoring engines like Nagios or Sensu and does event processing and notifications. Maybe that says a lot, and maybe there's to say a lot more, and I will try to cover that with my talk. What is the motivation of Flapjack? Firstly, we want to monitor things in an insane way. Say, like mad, like totally mad. Like every 10 seconds or faster. And existing systems are not fully designed for that. Say, if you have tried to use Nagios to monitor things every 10 seconds, you maybe have suffered from some drawbacks that Nagios had. And if you can point me to another tool that is able to do that, I would be quite happy. And actually, there's demand for that. So in my career as a consultant, I've seen quite a lot, maybe not all of them, but still quite a lot customers that want to monitor things quite fast. And every time that I argued that monitoring don't has to be that fast because humans aren't that fast, and in the end of the line, every time a human is sitting and getting the alert, there were always a lot of arguing and saying, yeah, but we need it. And we have SLAs, and we have this and that and whatever. Surely, say, there's a demand for that. And one of our biggest customers, Movember, is one of that demanding customers. They want the numbers. And they don't want only the numbers that I want to show you in a sec. They want all the numbers, like how much CPU usage have I now and 10 seconds before, and so on, and so on, and so on. What is Movember? Maybe I have to explain it over here. Movember is a charity organization that fundraises money to fund research for men's health. Say, they convince people to grow a mustache in November, and from that on, they call the month November Movember, with the M from mustache. And given that a lot of men doesn't look very nice with a mustache, and even less nice with a growing mustache, say the game is like shave on the 1st of November and grow that mustache for 30 days and yeah, basically look silly or ugly or whatever. And every time someone sees you like that, someone asks you, why do you do that? It's not the 70s anymore. And you say, yeah, I do that for charity, and now that you ask, please donate to Movember. And now that you ask, please go to a doctor and let test you for prostate cancer. And given that I don't see a woman in the audience today. Oh, sorry. I'm short-sighted. Yeah, I am. And I need new glasses, I know now. Sorry about that. But given the most of the audience is male, please do so. Go to a doctor and test your... let him do the tests. It's quite important. And yeah, Movember is quite successful with this silly game. They are active in 21 countries, and that's basically the English-speaking world, plus Western Europe. And they raise a lot of money. And in numbers, that's more than $140 million last year. And the number is not correct anymore. It's over 500 programs that they funded till today. So it's not only these numbers, they want CPU usage and memory usage and so on as well. And we try to give them that and to alert on that numbers, because we are following the thinking of we want to alert on what we graph. So if we have a chart, we want to have that chart first and want to have the alerting given from that chart. And you don't want to go to the thing that you want to check twice. So you only want to go there once, and because if you go there every 10 seconds or faster, or maybe even every 30 seconds, you don't want to do your alerting right on that fast pace. So we do not want to be bothered with too many alerts. We don't not want to be bothered with configuration of dependencies like parent-child dependencies, host or service dependencies, something like that we want to avoid. And there's one important thing: we cannot afford to restart monitoring every time we change something in the configuration. And that's quite a burden with Nagios till now. So we don't want to restart monitoring even on notification rule changes. So what is the... that's basically the motivation for building Flapjack. We want to aim at these drawbacks that are existing in existing monitoring systems and fight that. So, something about the history of Flapjack. In 2008, Lindsay Holmwood, which is now my boss in at Bulletproof in Sydney, and his colleague Matt Moore wanted to build the next generation monitoring system. And that's quite a bold thing to do. And the goals were simple to set up and operate, and it should have obvious paths to scale. So the year passes by, and in the next year, Lindsay was backpacking in Europe and started hacking on Flapjack. And by the mid of 2009, he has had a working prototype that runs basic monitoring checks. And basically that's it. The idea was simple: decouple the check execution from the alerting and notification, and use message queues to distribute check execution across lots of machines. But in the next 2 years, Flapjack was considered a dead project. Basically, Lindsay was the only person that developed on Flapjack, and during that time, he became a father, and obviously, that was more important to him than Flapjack. And I can quite understand that. I'm father of two kids as well, and it is important. And during that time, there were plenty of other interesting projects like Sensu with similar goals making excellent progress. Later on, Mott Gierman and others walked into the same direction, say message queues and decoupling check execution from alerting. And it's not a secret, other people were doing awesome work in the monitoring space as well during that time and till today. And last year, Flapjack was rebooted with a significantly altered focus, and check execution was no longer part of it. As of last year, check execution can be considered a solved problem. As we know now, and maybe should have known before, we can chart many instances of Nagios or Isinga or use ModGearman or whatever tool to distribute checks. And so check execution is not anymore the real problem. Flapjack is now focused on event processing, correlation and rollup, and is totally in the API-driven configuration thing. So there's a saying, how's it called? Give me an API or give me death. And I don't want to be die. I don't want to be death. And therefore, Flapjack has an API. Lucky me. The current state of Flapjack is we use Flapjack in production at Bulletproof since January, and we still heavily develop it. And rollup just got in, but it's not entirely finished yet, but it's on its way. I will give you some surrounding Flapjack facts. Firstly, it's full open source. It's licensed under an MIT license, under the MIT license, and the development is sponsored by Bulletproof. Up to 3 full-time engineers are working on it. And who are these 3? It's a distributed team. It's the father of Flapjack, Lindsay Holmwood, on the bottom left. Sadly, it's not that good seeable here. The guy in red is Jesse Reynolds, who works on Flapjack, and the guy on the right side is Ellie Graham. I've done some work on Flapjack, and maybe you. I strongly invite you to code on Flapjack as well and be part of the team. Some more surrounding facts. Flapjack is based on Redis and Event Machine, and it's written in Ruby, which could change later for some components if that is needed for speed reasons, for example. Or for other reasons, like the guy in the audience that is willing to code on Flapjack is better in another language. It's quite modular, so the other modules can be written in other languages. Some background. At Bulletproof, we've had a problem. We had to notify a dynamic group of people in different ways. These were thousands of people to be notified. It's not that Bulletproof is that big. It's like Bulletproof has a lot of customers, and they want to be notified as well. And because this group is dynamic, it's basically not doable to configure them as contacts in Nagios or something like that. Each of those individuals can have different notification settings based on time of day or week, the type of service affected, or the severity of the failure. And on call is just one fashion of those people. So we use the same tool to alert our customers that we use for our on call roster as well. Ongoing problem number two. We want to alert and make sure that the alerts get out, but we want to make sure nobody gets bombarded during outages. So we need some way of roll up or dampening or whatever. And we want to do the above in an API driven way. It must work in a multi-tenant environment with strong segregation between customers and integrate with existing monitoring and customer self-service stacks. So yeah, it has to work with the self-service portal that we have had up and running and still using, even if it's not ideal. I have one more page for background, and I intentionally not stated problem three here, but I called it humans. In the end, human beings are always the receiver of alerts. And Lindsay had given some great talks about the psychologic and human mechanisms of processing alerts. Some keywords here are hindsight bias, confirmation bias, or how I would say that, why do we don't accept to be wrong, and how that causes the inability to see mistakes. And another one on the rate of alerts that humans can or cannot handle. So I will give you a pointer to these talks. You can either Google for these talks or take the slides. I will put them online later on, and it's linked in there. The first talk was given on RubyConf in April this year, escalating complexity, DevOps learnings from Air France 447. Air France 447 was the flight that crashed into the Atlantic Ocean, don't know, some 2011 or so, don't know. And after 4 years of investigation, they stated it was human error. And there were alerts, like a stall warning on that flight, about 70 alerts, and the pilots didn't react. At least that's what the findings say. And this talk gives you a reason why that analysis is not correct. It's just too easy to say it's human error. And I highly recommend to listen to that talk, even if it's maybe mentally challenging. And the next one was given on DevOps Down Under in July. DevOps Field Guide to Understanding Cognitive Biases. That gives some insight in why do we avoid to recognize our own mistakes. Like maybe all of you have experienced this. I've written some code and used a library from some other guy, and it just doesn't work. And I'm digging in this library because obviously the error is in that library. And after 2 hours of digging and digging, just find out that I just used the library wrong. And these 2 hours are most likely we can blame these 2 hours on cognitive biases. We are not able to see our own mistake because it can't be there. The other guy is the guy with the mistake. And so that talk is very well worth seeing, and I recommend it as well. And the last one, I don't go into detail there, was given on Monitorama EU just last month. Psychology of Alert Design. So, what do I want to say with that, and how that correlate with Flapjack? We need a tool that doesn't overwhelm us with 70 alerts in, what was this, on the 447 flight, I think, in 10 minutes or so. So it doesn't help very, very much if you get a lot of SMSs or emails or whatever type of alert. You are just blind then, because too many lights show up, and yeah. So we need a tool to avoid that. And we try to do that with Flapjack. I will give you some insights on the architecture. We have an event producer, for example, a Flapjack Nagios receiver. We have an executive, in this case called Flapjack Executive, and we have a notifier. As of now, it is part of the Flapjack Executive, and we have gateways that are there for actually doing the alert. Gateways can be unidirectional or bidirectional, say email or SMS, or XMPP or PagerDuty. These gateways are implemented as pikelets, say Flapjack components, which can be run within the same Ruby process or as a separate process. And just text doesn't show that very well. Therefore, I give you a diagram. On the top, you have 2x Nagios with 2 processes called Nagios receiver. These are generating the events that are feed into Redis. And over here, you have the executive that looks up that state in Redis and processes that state through the notifier, generates the alerts, and gives the alerts to the gateways. And as you can see here, it's not one Nagios, it's an arbitrary number of check executors. Say Nagios is a word here for check executor. Say it could be collect D as well, or Isinga, or a mixture of that. Whatever you can get to send events into Redis could do as a check executor. And that's the reason why I said check execution is not a problem anymore. You can have one Nagios on every of your servers, and that Nagios will be happily execute checks every 10 seconds and feed the results into Redis via the Nagios receiver. So maybe one more word to Redis. Redis is a key value store, and it's quite fast in doing that. And it's maybe a bad tool for doing anything else, but for just that, it's maybe the best tool around. And therefore we don't see a bottleneck here. And even if there's a bottleneck, you can have more or multiple Redis instances as well. And same goes for the executive. It's also stated that you can have more than one. And same goes for the gateways. So all of these layers can be sharded and work in parallel. I want to talk about the events and the alerts that are generated and how they get processed. Event processing. In the following diagram, I will show you how that goes. We have an event, and we find failing events via filters. After that, we have a notification, and now we find people interested in the entity. Say, as of now, we have Alice, Bob, and Carol. And after that, we find media is owned by that people. Say, we have had Alice, Bob, and Carol, and now we have Alice with media email and SMS, Bob with media email, Bob with media SMS, and Carol with media SMS. And going on, we delete media based on tags, severity, or time of day. And we have just striked out Carol. So now, after the reduce step, we have Alice to be notified via email, SMS, and Bob via SMS. And we go on and delete media based on black holes that we can have and associate to people and notification types. And now we have Alice with SMS and Bob with SMS. And we go on and reduce and delete media based on notification intervals. And now we have Alice with SMS and Bob with SMS. Just an example. And last but not least, we have alerts. Two of them generated for Alice and Bob. Both of them go to the gateway SMS. Event filters. If you remember, on top of the diagram, we have had the filters. And the event filter work on status. Say you get the stream of events, like what Nagios generates when it checks. And the event filter will try to work out if that's a warning or a critical or a recovery or what's on that list, and only goes on when it's on that list. So only goes on if we actually want to generate an alert. In Flapjack, we don't have to pre-configure entities. So everything that we feed into Flapjack can be notified about. And if you want to add a new check executor that that checks whatever, some new servers, you just put that in, and all the new entities won't trigger alerts because they get an automatic maintenance on them. So new entities are in maintenance state and don't trigger an alert. Next thing is, if things are in a maintenance state, either automatically generated or manually put in, we don't get an alert. We don't get an alert if something is already acknowledged. And we don't get an alert before a small amount of a delay. At the moment, that is by default 30 seconds. And think of that like the soft states in Nagios. Notifications. Notifications are event driven. What does that mean? That means Flapjack needs the flow of incoming check results, or say events. If there's no check result coming in, Flapjack won't generate an alert. So if you just check every hour, you don't get an alert faster than every hour. And because Flapjack has to be in a critical or warning or say bad state, or has to see something in a critical or bad state first two times before it generates an alert, you only get an alert after 1 hour for a check that runs every half an hour. So Flapjack is event driven. The more often you check, the better. And notifications are time based. That means Flapjack alerts or hold back alerts according to time constraints. Say Flapjack generates the alert when the event comes in, but according to the time constraints that you've given. So if you say, for example, I want to be alerted every 10 minutes and you check every 10 seconds anyway, then you get alerts every 10 minutes by a delta of 10 seconds. And there's one more thing to say about notifications, and that is tags. You can use tags to direct notifications. Tags right now can use, Flapjack right now can use tags in notification rules to match against failing checks. Flapjack generates or creates auto tags from all the words in the entity name, say host name, in the check name, as you know, as a service name in Nagios, and from the summary output from the monitoring check, say the first line of output from Nagios. All these words are automatically generated tags that you can filter on. And you can add custom tags to entities. So you can tag a host with the tag top priority and set your notification rules to alert via SMS, email, and PagerDuty for that. Or you can tag nobody cares except Fred, and everyone but Fred could just set a notification rule to match this tag and black hole all the matching notifications to get rid of things that only Fred cares about. Flapjack has a simple web interface. There's a summary page and a all checks page, a failing checks page, and some more like contacts. I will show that in the demo, hopefully. And we have excellent documentation. And that means the documentation is in Git as well, in the Git wiki, GitHub wiki for Flapjack. And it says a lot about the API. For example, you can get all the outages like this, or you can use curl to get all the outages for one special host, something like that. And if the documentation is not correct, we do care about documentation, and if it's not correct, it's a bug. And if you find an error in our documentation, you can file that bug via GitHub, and it will get fixed. Quite sure, rather sooner than later. Something about the future of Flapjack. We have a roll-up feature that says you don't get 70 or whatever amount of alerts for something that you have set roll-up on. So as of now, roll-up works like can be described like the following. You said you want to get at most 10 SMSs, and after that want to get a roll-up SMS and not single and individual SMSs about failing checks anymore. And you can configure that. And so you get a roll-up, say a summary SMS every once in a while, whatever you have configured. And we want to improve that to, for example, catch the case when you have something not that important failing 5 times. So you have already used your 5 SMSs, and something more important fails after that, and you have configured to get only a summary SMS every hour, then maybe you have important information not at hand for an hour, and we want to go and catch that case as well. That's some thoughts about improvement on that. First point done. We want to make you feel welcome as much as we can. Therefore, have I noticed that we have documentation that is quite excellent? We have, and it's all on GitHub. We have a Vagrant Flapjack repository. So you can go and test for yourself. There can be done some improvements, but should be working right now. And we think about integrating that into OMD, maybe. Volunteers welcome. So, talk is cheap. Demo it.
One question, please.
Yeah.
Is Flapjack the right tool to make a connection to a ticket system as well? For Nagios or is
I don't know if we have actually thought about that, but I think it could be, yeah. A ticket system is just one more gateway, say. And if you can live with not having 70 or whatever alerts in your ticket system, but a summary ticket, could be a very interesting thing to do, yeah. Yeah, right. Yeah, I think about that. So I will try to do the demo. This is the basic Flapjack web interface. Flapjack is not designed to use the web interface, actually. Flapjack Web, the Flapjack Web Interface is, as of now, mainly to get an insight into Flapjack, and the actual use case is to generate the alerts and use the gateways to actually use Flapjack. And I've only configured localhost check on with Isinga in this case on the Vagrant box that I've put up for this, and it checks every 10 seconds and has notifications disabled because Flapjack is doing notifications now. We have only the localhost that has not to be configured in Flapjack at all. This information just comes from the incoming check results. So if something is not generating a check result, say is configured like a passive check or something like that, it won't show up in Flapjack. And this just reflects what we have in Isinga / Nagios like this.
Sorry?
Yep.
That I understand right. Passive checks don't make an alert on Flapjack?
If it's...
I have a passive check and it gets...
Yeah, but basically, the Flapjack Nagios receiver is connected to Isinga Nagios via the how's it called? No, not an event broker module. It's the like we've done it in the Audi setup, distributed Isinga setup. Performance data output, the performance data output pipe. And everything that goes there, and I'm actually not sure if passive checks were feed in there. If they do, it will show up in Flapjack. Are processed? Yeah. So, passive checks as well. But there was a Nagios version, I think 3.2, whatever, that didn't process empty performance data output. So, they weren't processed at all in that direction. And that was a bummer in that case. So just sad they didn't show up. So you have either use an older version of Nagios or use Isinga where this is fixed. And maybe it is fixed in newer Nagios versions as well. We haven't tried that. So I've only configured one contact. And that's Ada Lovelands. And it's just to show what is in there. Basically, you would actually use that by using the API. And I will show that in a sec. And then you can see internal statistics, how much goes through Flapjack. Basically, that's it. If you go and ask for the contacts via the web API, you will get this. And it's not nicely formatted because it shouldn't be human readable, but machine readable. Therefore, we have to do that in another way, maybe. if you go to the same page and just use curl to connect to that, you will get via piping through JSON PP, Pretty Printer for JSON, you will get the same information, just a bit prettier. Nothing special about that, but just that you know. And sorry. And you can use post as well for setting things like contacts. You can, this is a quite important thing. If you use that, you override all contacts in Flapjack. So you have to read and write in connection. And you can use a JSON curl command to just get contact set like this. And that's exactly what I've done to get Ada Lovelane in there. What else do we have? You can go to GitHub/Flapjack without the vocals. And you will find this. There's the actual Flapjack repository. And there's a extra repository for Flapjack Diner, which is an API consumer in Ruby. And you also have Vagrant Flapjack, which is the easy way to test Flapjack. You can go there, check out that repository, and actually try Flapjack with the latest version, more or less. And basically, I think that's it. Thank you. We are extremely interested in feedback. We want to know after this talk if you want to try Flapjack, and we want to know why not if you don't want to try it, and that would be very great if we can get this feedback, what we can do better, what we can do in another way to be more appealing to new customers and co-workers. And yeah, I just want to make that absolutely sure. You can either Twitter Lindsay Holmwood or Jesse Reynolds or Ailey Graham. I'm not that keen to do Twitter, so please mail me or create a issue in the Git repository. And now, questions. What do you want to know? Or do we want to give feedback right now?
What is the thing called black holes?
The black holes, yeah. It's like, I think. Yeah, it's like if you have a tag, like only Fred is interested in this. You can say by this, maybe it's even in the web interface. Let me have a look. Maybe it's in the web interface. I think there's no black hole configured, but maybe it's mentioned here. It is mentioned here. There are time restrictions. Say if you, yeah, and you can have black holes based on tags. And basically, that's it. Yeah. Or any alert with unknown in the check result. So if some check goes mad and produces just unknowns and you have had that for the last 2 days and you just can't get to debug it, but you know it's only once in a while and drives you crazy during the night, you can black hole it even on the output of the check, of the actual check. Please. No, you talk to via one of the gateways that are bidirectional, talk to Flapjack, and you can acknowledge them within Flapjack. So if you use PagerDuty, for example, they provide a service, a commercial service on alerting, and they have feedback implemented that goes back to Flapjack and sets the acknowledgement, or the second bidirectional provider that we have in place is XMPP, say Jabber, and you have your Jabber channel open and can directly talk to Flapjack. Maybe I can dig that up. Yeah, you can ask Flapjack for the history of every entity as well, and have that information at hand then. So yes, the way would be to ask Flapjack about states of things. Just because if you shard the other things, then you don't want to ask many multiple instances of Isinga, Nagios, whatever, for your SLA reports. Or you have to centralize that data anyway. Maybe the... Maybe I can show you the... This is Flapjack talking to Jabber and warning about something in the staging system. And I don't know if I get it correctly. You can ask, you can ask Flapjack for help and actually acknowledge something or find entities, checks, whatever, ask about something that is that has passed by a while before and see what Flapjack actually does and so it's basically, it's utilizing the API and talking to the internals. Yep.
Last question. Is it possible to correlate over two or more different entities? Do I want to be notified when that happens,
No, that, not at the moment. It's on the list to do, say, make the roll-ups better.
Any more questions? Okay, then thank you, Birger, for the presentation.